Today we have Dr. Mary Cooper, Program Director and Associate Professor at Thomas Jefferson University College of Population Health. She's also the co-lead Health System Sciences Curriculum, the Sidney Kimmel Medical College, Thomas Jefferson University, and the Chief Quality Officer and Senior Vice President of Clinical Services, Connecticut Hospital Association. We also have Tara McKinley, PharmD, Managed Market Liaison, Field Medical Affairs for OTSCA, and me, your moderator, Joe Cirrincione, PharmD MBA, Senior Managed Market Liaison from Field Medical Affairs, also with OTSCA. Okay, we have a few objectives for today's webinar. The first being define population health, also understand and differentiate population health and population health management, provide an overview of the drivers of population health, explore current U.S. healthcare and chronic kidney disease, review kidney health initiatives in the United States, and finally, discuss the role of population health strategies in chronic kidney disease. So, all right, let's begin our session. I'm going to turn the slides over to Tara to talk about what is population health.
Thank you, Joe. So happy to be here today and alongside Dr. Cooper as well. We're really excited for all of our attendees as well for this conversation. So with that, I'll dive right in. So population health, while in the history of medicine, has not been around as long, it's a relatively new term. It's in the previous few decades, in 1978 was one of the first definitions that population health came about. But more recently in 2003, population health researcher David Kindig coined the phrase population health being the health outcomes of a group of individuals, including the distribution of these outcomes within the group. Now, these groups can be very specific or also perhaps more broad. So a specific example might be a particular disease state. You know, today we're talking about chronic kidney disease, but it can also be more broad, talking about communities, nations, ethnicities, genders, and so on. So really talking about different populations within a group of people. Population health management is the management of those groups, the health of individuals. And so what we see between plans is that this can vary a lot because we know populations are broad, health management strategies are very diverse, and you see lots of variation. So there's no one specific strategy to managing the health of populations, but identifying your populations and then moving forward from there is a good place to start.
And I think this is a great area to really talk to Mary and get your opinion on where you really see population health going.
So thanks, Joe, and thanks, Tara. Thank you, everybody, for joining us today and having me. I just want to emphasize, as we're starting, I am not a nephrologist. And, you know, chronic kidney disease is managed by nephrologists, generally. I am trained in internal medicine, but really my background is in healthcare quality and safety and population health, and I've been doing that for 30 years for healthcare quality and safety and population health for the past 6 years. As a result, I'm actually one of the older people in terms of population health. It really, although David Kindig coined the phrase almost 20 years ago, especially in the US health system, it only started to take hold about 6 or 7 years ago when we really started to see health systems, integrated delivery networks embrace the concept of population health, and at that time start to devote resources to it. So they started putting people in to those positions within their organizations and giving them the mandates of trying to get their arms around populations in order to improve their outcomes. And that's when we really started to see it really take a lot of emphasis in terms of health outcomes. I'm fortunate to work at the first College of Population Health that was developed in the country. We're only 10 years old. And so many of the people that we trained are now out in the US healthcare systems. And if you look at the federal government and state government responses, most of them have been focused on public health rather than population health. But as we move forward, I think you're going to see much more emphasis on population health, especially because of the value proposition that's associated with population health management.
Thank you, Mary. And that's, you know, you hit the nail on the head there and, you know, leading perfectly into the next slide here, that public health and population health they're really becoming one and the same. It's hard to differentiate the two. The policies within one or the other, the health outcomes, looking at rules and regulations, legislations, all of these are so impactful on how the health outcomes of the individuals and the groups are coming to be. And social determinants of health are talked about so much nowadays with health systems, and again in public health as well. We see health disparities being an important piece. And I think this is where it's really becoming a change in how we're looking at healthcare. We know that where people live, some of their cultural differences, these are really having major impacts on the outcomes of the healthcare of individuals, not just focusing on the disease state itself and the treatments for those disease states, but really starting to dig into some of those historical aspects of family, where people are living, what regulations and rules, what states they're living in, even air quality, all of these things are really coming into a play and starting to change healthcare as we see it today, which, you know, is a good thing. So social determinants of health, again, this is a term, it's kind of a buzz phrase nowadays. I think everyone's talking about it because it's so important to think about where we're born, we live, work, play, worship, and so on. This is affecting so much of the health outcomes. I believe the citations say, you know, 70 to 80% of these factors are influencing the health of populations. So thinking about public safety, language and health literacy, all of these things that are going to be essential to making sure that we're providing quality care for patients moving forward.
And Tara, if I can jump in and just augment that as it's related to a chronic kidney disease patient population, when you look at social determinants of health being responsible for such an aggregate part of the outcomes of people and medical care, which in chronic kidney disease is what we usually think of, the medications, the interventions, putting people on dialysis when they have end-stage renal disease, for example. We think of that as medical care, but the data really show that 10% of outcomes are related to medical care as opposed to the large proportion related to social determinants of health. And if you think about that in a CKD patient population, we think about things like access to medications, for example. So if you're a patient who has early stage CKD and could benefit from certain medications that would decrease the likelihood of progression, but you don't have easy access either because of your payer coverage, your insurance coverage, or because of access to a pharmacies near you, you may not be able to get that medication and be able to keep it, you know, sort of in your house readily. Or in the alternative, because you have food insecurity or a lack of food every month, you may be spending your money on food as opposed to on your medication. So when we look at the impact of social determinants of health on this particular patient population, there is so much opportunity out there to intervene early before we get to end-stage renal disease and really change the cost curve, change the trajectory of disease, and really make people's lives better early on.
I completely agree. I mean, education even is a huge factor in the outcomes. You know, there was a study done showing that those with less than 12 years of formal education have adverse outcomes in chronic kidney disease. They're showing impaired kidney, you know, more impaired kidney function in these populations, you know, whether it's due to lack of education around the health prevention and all of this, but there's studies tying these together now that we're really starting to see where these social determinants of health are actually impacting, you know, truly being tied together.
Well, that's a great point, Tara, because that concept of health literacy, so people understanding their own disease, it's not the same as literacy with being able to read or to write, but that concept of health literacy, where you really understand what's happening to your body and what the potential outcomes are if you don't do anything about it, is really important, again, in slowing down the progression of disease. So if I know, for example, that I don't want to do something that is potentially going to make my kidneys worse, such as if I have hypertension, which is a big risk factor for chronic kidney disease, and I'm going to take my meds, or I'm going to decrease the stress in my life, or I'm going to get more exercise, or any of those things, understanding the cause and effect is really huge for patients to get engaged or activated in the likelihood of changing their outcome. So I think your point that education, and especially education as it relates to health literacy, is really critical.
Yep. Very much so. And you talked on, you know, that Blacks and Hispanics are at greater risk of diabetes and hypertension, which we know are factors associated with kidney disease. And so I think as health plans, you know, providers, if we start to hone in on some of these characteristics of people and populations as a whole, and realizing that some are at greater risk than others, this is where we can tailor some of our health resources and maybe try to use more population health strategies moving forward.
I think you're right, Tara. And in fact, when we look at patient populations and we look at the differences in different races and ethnicities and cultures, et cetera, one of the things we always have to be cautious about is, you know, bringing implicit bias in, where we have certain perspectives that influence some of the decisions we make in treating patients. So if, for example, we're not looking for disease, especially in chronic kidney disease, we're not going to find it, regardless of what the person in front of us looks like. On the other hand, if we automatically assume that someone is going to not take care of their health because we have biases that may influence some of our approaches, that is as big a factor about the risk of that person not going forward, because we in the profession as clinicians, we take a large responsibility for not managing people's health well. So for example, when you look at clinicians and their treatment of hypertension, there's so much variability among, I'm going to use physicians as the example, because that's really what's been studied most as opposed to other providers. But there's so much variability in the way that physicians manage hypertension, and accelerating the number of medications that a patient with hypertension is placed upon so that hypertension comes in control, or even the amount of control that the person does for the patient and how low the patient's blood pressure actually gets. And we know, there's good evidence in literature, we know the higher the level of hypertension, the more end organ damage that we see in patients. And so our responsibility is as much of a part of the puzzle as is the patient who's presenting in front of us.
Very much so. If we could have you talk to every provider out there, Dr. Cooper, we'd be set. All right, we'll move on. So as Dr. Cooper touched on, there's been a lot of change around population health recently,